Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our roundtable on the New York City Board of Election. My name is State Senator Liz Krueger, and I am joined in this roundtable partnership with Senator Zelnor Myrie, who is the chair of the Elections Committee, Assemblywoman Neely Rozic, who is the co-sponsor of a bill with me to try to address problems specifically with the operation of the New York City Board of Election. And that's what this roundtable is specifically about. There are many other issues, I believe, that we need to fix through statutory changes, reforming how we run our elections and what the rules of the road are. And I'm very excited that under the leadership of Zelnor Myrie and his Elections Committee, I believe the Senate will be taking on many of those issues come the new year. But we thought that we would just sort of kickstart the issues we're seeing in New York City, specific to problems identified by the way the Board of Election is established in the law and run. So far already this morning, we are joined by my colleagues, Senator Andrew Gunardis, Senator John Liu, Senator Roxanne Perceau. I think those are the other electeds right now.
Andrew Gunardis.
I said Andrew Gunardis.
Sorry, you got me.
Oh.
Sorry. thank you. But we've actually been RSVP'd by quite a few other elected officials who I think will be joining us over the course of the next 4 hours. That's our estimate of the time frame. Again, the bill that Neely and I have introduced is Senate number 2726A, which outlines the responsibilities of both members of the Board of Election and the executive director of the Board of Election. This legislation would also create a clear delineation of responsibility and accountability so that the issues can be identified and remedied. We believe there are additional proposals for change that are being submitted by people testifying today and others, and the Assemblywoman and I are going to evaluate those proposals going forward and are very likely to have an amended version of the bill that we are ready to introduce come the new year. Without taking any more time up today, Senator Zelnor Myrie, do you have any opening statements?
Good morning, everyone. And thank you to Senator Krueger for bringing us together. I'm excited to hear the feedback today. I had the honor of chairing the Elections Committee in the Senate, and both the Senate and the Assembly have demonstrated a willingness and an ability to reform the election law. In the first 2 years of a Democratic majority, we made over 60 changes to the election law, and there is much more to come. Senator Krueger mentioned that we will be having a hearing in the new session that looks at the entire state, looks at how our elections went in November and June, and there will be a lot of discussion on how we can move forward. But this is an important bill, and this is an important hearing, because I think New Yorkers expect a world-class democracy. They expect world-class service. And that is ultimately who we are talking about today, the New York City voter. We recognize that the New York City Board of Elections had to perform under unprecedented circumstances. We had a pandemic that changed the way that we elect who represents us. And the Board of Elections was not immune to having to work with a diminished staff. They weren't immune to experiencing some of the tragedies of COVID-19. But there were also some steps that I think that we can take to help improve the process. Much like every other institution, I think this pandemic allows us an opportunity to push for some things that we may not have been able to get without this pandemic. And we've seen that in the housing context, the healthcare context, and the education context. So I'm looking forward to hearing the feedback from all of the stakeholders today. And once again, I want to thank Senator Krueger and of course, Assemblymember Rozic for the sponsorship of this bill.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. And Assemblywoman Neely Rozic from Queens. Welcome to our Senate roundtable. I'm so glad that you crossed the line to join us today.
Thanks, Senator Krueger, and to my Senate colleagues for doing this and for including me, to be quite frank. I'm here in support of legislation that Senator Krueger and I carry, mostly because, you know, we've seen in 2020 alone comically long lines, poll sites that didn't open on time, issues with ballot scanners, and certainly disproportionate number of voters voting at different early voting sites, which was problematic throughout the city. The bottom line is that no other government entity could have such a dismal track record, and this is going back not just this election, but previous elections as well, and face no accountability. I think what we need here is more transparency and accountability to sort of stem some of the problems that we've seen, and to be quite honest, further impact that could lead to, you know, further corruption or even worse. So I'm excited about the bill that Liz and I are introducing together. To be quite honest, we can't really wait until we do a constitutional amendment. We need to see some real changes happening right now, and I'm excited to hear from the experts today on how we can go about that. Thank you.
Thank you. And let's see, we've been joined by Senator Robert Jackson and Senator Brad Hoylman. So welcome to you both as well. And just before I turn it over to our first panel, you know, I could have read out an incredibly long list of the problems we've seen recently in the New York City elections. But I realized after just Googling New York City election problems, and you get like 37 pages of media reports, that I would just tell everyone who was listening today, if they didn't think there was evidence of problems, if they are on this roundtable today, they are computer literate. So just type into Google and you can read article after article after article about the problems just from the most recent elections. I didn't even go back in time. These were the 2020 articles. So with that, I would like to welcome as our first testifiers, Deputy Mayor Philip Thompson from the City of New York, and Laura Wood, who is the, let me get the title right, I'm sorry. I have it written in front of me and I have to just pull it up. You know, actually, Laura, I don't have your title. So when you testify, you'll tell us your title. But I think we're starting with Phil Thompson.
Thank you very much, Senator, and also Senator Myrie, thank you. And let me just say that even before I started as deputy mayor, I used to go around the country saying that the New York legislature, and particularly the Senate, has the most far-sighted and intelligent and progressive minds in the whole country. And I really am excited about the future of New York State because of many of these folks I'm looking at right now. And I just wanna say that. I think, you know, New York and California are gonna lead the country, you know, through example, really believe that. So before I start my testimony, I just wanna say in the 1980s, I was writing a doctoral dissertation on voter participation in New York, Atlanta and Oakland, and whether the Jesse Jackson campaigns had affected it and so on. And I interviewed people at the Board of Elections. There was a woman there named Grace who had been there for like 45 years in the 1980s. And I wrote 100 pages in my dissertation just about the Board of Elections in the 1980s and all the things that were bad and needed to change. And my dissertation committee was Donna Shalala, Fran Piven, Marilyn Gattell. And later when I turned it into a book, the editor said, take all that stuff out. Nobody cares about that stuff. And that could not be more untrue today. People care about these long lines. People care about all the different hoops and hurdles they have to go through just in order to express their right to vote. I learned a long time ago that the right to vote was precious. In fact, there were those who would stop at nothing to try and rip away that right. My first job out of college was working for the Tennessee Hunger Coalition. And my job was to work in Southwest Tennessee and register people to vote. And that's where I learned about literacy tests and poll taxes. That's where I saw company foremen taking down the names of workers who showed up at the polling place and cast ballots. And later those workers were fired for voting. It was only a little later that my wife, who served as a voting rights attorney for the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, worked on a case in Jackson, Tennessee, Southwest Tennessee, and she was defending a Black store owner who was going around getting his friends and neighbors, registering them to vote. He was warned to stop. He didn't stop. And one day, his store was set on fire and his eight-year-old daughter was killed in that fire. All of this for trying to help Black people exercise their most basic right in democracy. I tell you these stories because every time we talk about the right to vote, this is the weight that communities of color in particular have carried with us for a long time. Somehow in the year 2020, in New York, we are fighting the same fight. We look at states like Georgia and see people in line at the polls for hours and hours. We see challenges to early voting. And people kind of expect to see that in Georgia or Mississippi. But we're seeing these same challenges here in New York State. And it shocks many people to realize that we're fighting the same battles here too. We see challenges to early voting. We see polling places mysteriously closed down or not open at all. More and more New Yorkers are realizing the fight for voting rights and equal protection applies in our state as well. The pandemic of 2020 caused unique challenges, no doubt about it. But the problems we saw with the Board of Elections, as I said earlier, are nothing new. This time, it was incorrect oath envelopes and absentee ballots and a large disparity in early voting site breakouts leading to 5-hour lines in some sites. In June's primary, it was a lack of training for poll workers, resulting in voters not receiving both their local and presidential ballots. And in 2016, it was thousands of Brooklyn voters being purged from the voter rolls. These stories don't even reflect the daily struggle of voters receiving incorrect information from Board of Election phone operators, sometimes after waiting on hold for hours. Each misstep means we lose New Yorkers' trust in our electoral system. Disproportionately, the pain is felt by those who have historically been most disenfranchised at the polls. It forces those who can least afford to relitigate these challenges into a position where they must fight for their right to cast a vote. Groups like African Americans, Latinos, Southeast Asians, people with disabilities, and immigrants. We are grateful for the significant voting reforms the state legislature has passed in recent years, which have made a real difference, but there are still a ways to go. And the cause of many of the remaining challenges is the city Board of Elections' current structure. It is inefficient, it lacks uniformity across our 5 boroughs, and it is not accountable to New Yorkers. Our administration has offered the City Board of Elections financial incentives to self-reform. They have repeatedly refused the support. Now we believe we have crossed the Rubicon. We must reassess election law to make the City Board of Elections more accessible and accountable to New York City voters. Democracy NYC, which is headed by Laura Wood, who you'll meet later, has been at the forefront of efforts to convene community partners across the city to gather feedback. From these initial conversations, we have found consensus with a two-pronged approach to Board of Election reform, short-term legislation, and constitutional reform. We're grateful for Senator Krueger championing the Board of Election Reform Bill, Senate Bill 2726A, and also for Assembly Bill 11169. Originally a mayoral program bill, and under Senator Krueger's leadership in organizing this roundtable, she is really galvanizing folks to work on how can we strengthen the bill and improve the bill. We're thankful for that. And also for Nile Rosick. Beyond the boundaries of the bipartisan requirement in the state constitution, the statutory framework of the election law, we believe, provides ample opportunity to change the city board of elections. At the top, we must find ways to professionalize staff and incentivize them to perform in the interests of voters while protecting them from political blowback. Give New York City more oversight over operations and require more accountability to the public. Potential reforms to achieve these goals include modifying the Board of Commissioners appointment process, modifying the process for the appointment of the executive director, imposing professional qualifications for board commissioners, imposing commissioner term limits, and requiring that the board provide more transparent reporting on their operations, data, and spending. Additionally, there are functions currently performed by the board that are not expressly itemized in the Constitution and could be given to a centralized staff or a city agency, including designing election districts and poll sites and conducting voter education. Reform will not come easily, as our community partners have expressed to us, but the will of the people must be heard. Our leaders must decide whether we'll protect people's democratic rights and make those rights free and easy, or whether we'll continue to place obstacles in the way of New Yorkers. I personally believe that if you're a low-income person and can't afford a daycare or babysitter for 5 hours, or can't afford to take a day off to vote, then because you don't have money, then we have something in place which to me is identical with the poll tax. That's how it operated in the South. That was its purpose, and it's happening here and now. It is time to listen to the people and capture this momentum to change New York for the better. Thank you.
Thank you. So I did let Deputy Mayor Thompson go over time, but it's because it was my fault. I didn't tell everyone at the beginning that there's a 5-minute limit on the testimony, and then each legislator who asks questions gets a 5-minute total to ask questions, and we'll see if people need second rounds. So there is a clock that I think all of us can see before us. Now, since it's a panel with Laura Wood, I'm gonna let Laura Wood testify also, and then I'll invite the legislators to ask their questions. And we have been joined by Senator Leroy Comrie since last time I announced people. So welcome, Leroy. And I'll turn it over to Laura for her 5 minutes. You have to unmute, Laura. Nope, you're still on mute. There you go.
Sorry about that. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Senator Krueger, and to Senator Myrie and Assembly Member Rosick and all of the senators who have joined today. I really want to thank you so much for your leadership on issues of election reform and for everything you've done in the last few years to modernize elections. My name is Laura Wood, and I am the Senior Advisor and General Counsel to the Democracy NYC Initiative at the Mayor's Office. In the office of Deputy Mayor Thompson, the Office of Strategic Policy Initiatives. As such, as I explained to Josh, his testimony is submitted jointly with Democracy NYC, and therefore maybe he didn't officially go over his time. We just want to say that we really believe that BOE reform is absolutely key to our mission of increasing voter access, fostering civic engagement, and promoting voter turnout for all New York City residents. So really so delighted to hear from all of you today and from the other panelists to see if we can agree on the best path forward. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, so that was it for you? So you're right, you did not go over. You're letting people give questions. I will start with asking whether Neely or Senator Myrie have questions first. And if they don't, John Liu, oh, I did already. Senator John Liu has already highlighted he has questions. Zelnor, do you have questions?
I do not, Senator.
Okay. So Senator Liu, please feel free to ask either testifier questions.
Thank you, Senator Krueger. I am so thankful that you convened this roundtable and that our chairman, Zelnor Myrie, continues to enhance the democracy we have here in the state of New York. I think this bill that you and Assemblymember Rosick have put together is a great bill. It's a needed bill. And, you know, I'll start by saying that we have continuing issues with voting and the election process here in not only New York City, but the state as well. The New York City Board of Elections in particular is a frequent target for criticism. Perhaps rightly so, sometimes perhaps unfairly. Whatever the case may be, I think it makes absolute sense to delineate the responsibilities between the top staff, the salaried staff of the board, which would be the executive and deputy executive directors, of which you have noted are of different parties, and the commissioners themselves. There is sometimes a great deal of confusion among the public, as well as among candidates and elected officials, who is responsible for making what kinds of determinations. So this bill is needed. I fully support it. And my question to Deputy Mayor Thompson and Laura Wood would be that I assume you support this bill. I don't know, Senator Krueger, if I would be out of order to ask this question, but I would perhaps pose a question to the deputy mayor as to whether the board as currently made up and functioning is ready for ranked choice voting in February in the special elections coming up.
There are no bad questions, Senator Liu, so.
Thank you.
I'll let Laura start with that because she talks to the Board of Elections all the time. I'll follow up if needed. Go ahead.
Thank you, Senator. That is a very critical question that I know is on a lot of New Yorkers' minds right now. I think in terms of the board's readiness to roll out ranked choice voting in February, you know, it remains to be seen. I think that, while they have had a lot thrown at them in the past year, certainly, and I know that many of the staff work incredibly hard and have worked incredibly hard, you know, they we're all here today because they don't have the best track record. I think it's, you know, I know that there's litigation going on. I'm not going to comment on pending litigation. I will say that from my perspective, it might be a good thing that ranked choice voting is starting out in a single, relatively small special election rather than rolling it out citywide all at once. But, you know, I don't think that the board has demonstrated yet that they are fully ready. And I think the key question that is on everyone's mind that arose earlier this week at a city council hearing is what type of education and outreach is being done? And that's something, you know, Democracy NYC is going to be focused very much on that council district in Queens in the next 2 months, to less than 2 months, the election's February 2nd. To make sure that we are working with grassroots organizations, faith-based leaders, and others in that community to get them the materials that they need. And then we're gonna, you know, roll that out citywide as we get closer to the June primary. But I think there's still a lot of questions to be answered on that. And I just wanted to also get back to your comment about the legislation with Senator Krueger, and I believe Senator Hoylman is a co-sponsor, and obviously Assemblymember Rozic. We do support that. In fact, that was originally a mayoral program bill. And we are really excited today to talk about whether there are ways to strengthen the bill, because we think that there is a lot that can be done legislatively short of amending the Constitution to further professionalize the board and make it more transparent and accountable.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you. And John, if you want a second round later, we'll come back to you. We've been joined also by Senator Gustavo Rivera. Just wave if you have questions right now, any of the senators on the listening in, although some of you don't have your cameras on. Oh, Robert Jackson. Yes.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for pulling this together. I'm juggling, obviously. I was in a meeting earlier, and I'm listening in on the meeting while my camera's off because I'm having breakfast, and then I got to run out of here to Brooklyn regarding some individuals that are incarcerated over in New Jersey. The Mexican Park leadership is having a press conference. But I have a couple of questions. One, I always hear, whether or not I was in the city council or now in the state senate, that the Board of Elections feels that they don't have enough money to really run the program like it's supposed to. So if you can opine on that. And then number two, how do you envision, if in fact this is changed, how do you envision the Board of Election being quote unquote non-political in that respect? So those are two quick questions that I have.
Why don't I answer the money question, and then I'll turn to you, Laura, on the non-political question. And before that, John Liu raised the question about ranked choice voting. I just want to say quickly, one issue is whether the Board of Elections is ready. Another issue is whether candidates are ready. And I say that because the family that hosted me for a year when I was writing my doctoral dissertation in Oakland, California, one of the people was a woman named Jean Kwan, and she ran for mayor in Oakland when they started ranked choice voting, and her campaign just said, make me your number two. And the other candidates didn't really understand like how the ranked choice voting thing would play out. So all the number ones canceled each other out, but she was everybody's number two, and she became mayor. And I think she became the first Chinese American mayor in California, I believe. So I think there's a lot of education that has to happen at all levels for voters, for candidates, for everybody. So I just wanted to mention that. Second, the city has offered to pay the Board of Elections for improving their operations. And very often those offers of financial support have been rejected. And so one of the things we really want, we're willing to pay to improve operations, to have voting more accessible, but we also want accountability, because if we're paying for it, we'd like to see where the money actually goes. And right now we don't see that either. If we put money in the Board of Elections, it's a black hole. And we don't know what happens. So I'll end with that and turn to Laura.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor, and thank you, Senator, for the questions. I think as far as the depoliticization of the board, that is very much steeped in the culture, and it comes from the top, of course. And one thing we are conscious of is that there is actually this constitutional requirement of bipartisanship. In not just the city BOE, but the state and all of the counties throughout. And this bill, this isn't a constitutional amendment. That is something that, perhaps is a conversation for later or another day. But what this bill would attempt to do is, within that constitutional framework, take some steps to further professionalize the staff and perhaps even the commissioners as well. You know, one thing that we've been mulling over at Democracy NYC is whether we should actually impose some qualifications or training, not just for the staff, but for the commissioners themselves. That's not prohibited under the constitutional framework. But at minimum, we think that having more, better, clearer standards for staff would help go a long way towards professionalizing the board. We've spoken with DCAS, for example. This is something that they do every single day, is work with agencies to come up with, organizational structures that make sense, create qualifications for different job titles, do extensive trainings. And we know that since the election law gets updated regularly, there would need to be regular trainings. Those are all things that we very much support and think would really help with professionalizing even within this bipartisan framework.
Thank you. I know Senator Hoylman had his hand up before, has been waiting patiently. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Krueger. Thank you, Assemblymember Rozic, and of course, Chair Zellner-Myrie, for all of your work and my colleagues. And Senator Krueger, I'm very proud to be a co-sponsor of your legislation. I hear a lot about this issue from my constituents. And I'll add an anecdote that I actually heard some good news from my constituents on the actual day of the general election. Many reported back to me that they found the poll workers to be far better, skillful and adept at handling the crush of voters. And they even cited a spirit of cooperativeness and civic kind of revival at the polling sites that they hadn't experienced before. Usually it's a complete exercise in frustration, even though so many of them were waiting for hours in lines. I'll mention that I sponsor legislation to allow New York State to join the 33 other states and the District of Columbia that have drop boxes where voters can bypass polling sites altogether and vote much more conveniently. And I hope we can have that considered in Senator Myrie's committee in the next session. But I wanted to ask a couple of things, and it's good to see Laura Wood again. We all used to work for her, right, Liz? Mm-hmm. The question is, what changed between the primary and the general that actually made things go better on the ground? And then secondly, the second question is, do you think this bill, is it a first step? And do we need to really look at the issue raised by Senator Jackson and by the deputy mayor in terms of throwing the partisanship requirement out the window with a constitutional amendment? So that's to both Laura and the deputy mayor, or whoever wants to answer.
Please start, Laura.
Absolutely. Thank you, Senator Hoylman. Great to see you. I think, and thanks for your anecdote and support for more drop boxes. We also think that would be a great step. In terms of what changed between the primary and the general, I think a couple of things. First of all, the state of the city leading up to the June primary was obviously, it was horrific. It was we were really in full crisis mode. And I think, to give the Board of Elections credit, I think they did the best they could with literally just being pummeled with changes, whether it was coming out of, executive orders from the governor's office or just changes to the calendar. As you know, is the presidential primary happening? Is it not? There was just so much going on. And they had to roll out a massive absentee ballot operation on very short notice. So I think part of what changed is that they just had a bit more time to prepare. I also think your session in July was incredibly helpful in providing some clarity about what the law would be governing the general election. And I think, you know, the other thing that we, and I know many other advocates did, was, you know, really engage in a very big campaign to promote awareness about early voting. You know, we did the same about absentee voting, both in June and for the general. But, you know, our view going into the general was that early voting was a great way for people to vote in person and do so on their own time and, you know, in a safe, socially distant way. I think, needless to say, people definitely got the message about early voting. And, you know, unfortunately, the reality is that, as Deputy Mayor Thompson described, there were massive lines, and that led to a whole host of other problems.
There seem to be new poll workers. Where did they come from?
There was a nationwide effort, which we supported and assisted with, to try to recruit lots of new poll workers. Obviously, historically, a lot of poll workers in the city are seniors. Many of them did work, you know, for these elections, but I think because of COVID or for other reasons, there was you know, some of them didn't want to work in person. And the board needed more poll workers because they had more early voting sites than they ever had before. So I agree. I was really pleased at all the poll sites I visited and where I voted. The professionalism was, you know, was really high, and there was a lot of energy. So hopefully that will continue.
Yes, and I guess that's the essence of my question. How do we, that kind of illuminates Senator Krueger's and Assemblymember Ruzick's bill. How do we make that permanent?
Well, I think that, you know, part of what would help is passing legislation like this, which would provide more transparency about the process. I mean, I think, you know, the quality of the poll workers, I think, was better, but we still don't know that much about the actual process. We know that many, many people applied and even went through training and did not receive assignments, or, you know, didn't even receive any follow-up from the board. There were also reports of massive amounts of poll workers being sent to these sort of holding rooms. I think there was one at the Javits Center, and sitting around for hours and hours, particularly on election day. So, you know, the poll workers themselves, I think, are, you know, true heroes working these incredibly long shifts. But I still think the board needs to do better by them and needs to, you know, be more communicative about, you know, when they can expect to get their assignment. I think all of the training materials should be made public. The public should be able to watch a poll worker training, in my view. And I also think that we really should continue to emphasize trying to recruit young people. I know Assemblymember Ruzick has a bill that would explicitly make it easier to recruit college students to serve as poll workers, which the administration supports, and really looking at split shifts so that you don't have to work from 5 a.m. until 10 p.m. or later on election day. I think you can improve your quality substantially if you do that.
Thank you. So I have a couple of questions that I really think are targeted to City Hall. So the Board of Election has to find poll sites. Now they have to find early poll sites as well as poll sites, and early poll sites have to meet a standard of being willing to do this for 9 or 10 days in a row. So after the first attempts with early voting, we learned that schools with children going through them for the most of the 9 or 10 days, it was quite chaotic. And I, in fact, put a bill in that passed the Senate, but it didn't pass the Assembly yet, that says you can't use a public school for early voting, because frankly, it was our experience that this was sort of a recipe for disaster, both for the school and their kids and their teachers, and for the voters. So then we didn't get that through the assembly. That's not really my point. But the mayor said, we won't use schools again for early voting because it proved to be a disaster. Then fast forward, everyone's looking for poll sites. In certain areas, they couldn't find poll sites. And so we went back to using a few schools for early voting. But really the punchline was, we couldn't find enough locations, at least in Manhattan, and I'm from Manhattan, for early voting poll sites, resulting in way too many voters being assigned to any given poll site, resulting in 4-hour lines at our early voting sites, at least in my district, day after day after day. When you would ask, why didn't the Board of Election find more poll sites? And they asked the local electives to tell them ideas of what they should use. And I know that my office did. And they'd come back and say they don't want to do it. But under law, if they're getting city money, they're supposed to have to do it. So I'd say to the Board of Election, they're not allowed to say no. Go to City Hall and tell them that they have to make these mostly arts institutions, although some other institutions agree. They're getting government money and they don't have the right to say no. And yet the board felt that there was no one listening to them. I don't know if they asked you all to do this or not. They would just tell me that nobody was saying yes to them. So they were between a rock and a hard place. Were they asking you to help? Were you not able to help? Can't you say to institutions and other locations that get government money, you know, here's the deal, guys. You don't do this, you don't get any more city money. So I'm really curious whether it's a legislative language issue or whether it's a willingness to actually do what's supposed to be done at City Hall when it comes to this part of the assignment.
Well, the selection of poll sites, particularly early voting sites, is a really critically important topic. So thank you for raising it. And, you know, I think, well, a few things. First of all, we at Democracy NYC have repeatedly offered the board assistance in selecting poll sites. We have spoken to cultural institutions on their behalf. We have actually gone out and essentially recruited poll sites and shared that information with the board. They have continued to operate in a way that is completely lacking in transparency and have not been receptive to our repeated offers of assistance. And this goes back to last spring, spring of 2019, when they were first required to identify early voting sites for the upcoming primary and general election. I think there's clearly an issue where we think the state legislature can be very helpful, because the poll site selection language in the election law predates the early voting statute. And so what we think has happened is that because the election law gives the Board of Elections, first of all, basically sole discretion to select poll sites, and then gives them additional ability to designate schools as poll sites, because schools under the election law are basically the only type of site that cannot object to being designated as a poll site. What we've seen, with the exception of Queens, is that the four other counties, if they have trouble lining up other sites, will fall back on schools. And so that, we think, is a structural issue that absolutely, you know, and we thank Senator Krueger for her legislation, which we support. We think that would be extremely helpful. And I think we would favor more clear language requiring other institutions to serve as poll sites. We have made very clear to cultural institutions that they should step up. I think a lot of it depends on how willing the board and the commissioners from a particular county are to kind of take this on. I remember, again, before early voting rolled out in November 2019, the Museum of the Moving Image in Queens, they had been designated, did not want to serve as an early voting site. The board was threatening litigation. We got on the phone, we got involved, we convinced them to do it. And lo and behold, they've now served as an early voting site, I think at least three, if not more times. And I think it's actually been really beneficial, certainly for the voters who live in the community, but also for the institution itself. And we saw, Brooklyn Museum, King's Theater, many other sites step up in the last few months. And so I hope that we can get more culturals on board. The other thing I would just quickly note, and I know Senator Myrie is well aware of this, but in addition to increasing the number of sites, we really need to talk about countywide or eventually citywide early voting sites so that voters have more flexibility about where they vote early, particularly when we get past the worst of the pandemic and hopefully people are returning to work. Wouldn't it make sense if people who work in Midtown can go vote at Madison Square Garden regardless of where they live? So we are very, very hopeful that we can ultimately get there as well. But in the meantime, we want to work with the legislature to address these structural issues.
Good, thank you. And in fact, Zellner, the bill that we passed about the public schools not being used for early voting also had language strengthening the hand of the Board of Election to make cultural institutions or others who have city or state subsidy or payments have to participate unless they have very specific reasons that they can't. So I do think, the bizarre thing about the pandemic is it has jump-started early voting and absentee voting in a way that we're never going backwards from. So anyone who thinks that was some fluke because of the pandemic, it may be a fluke that we all jumped into it so quickly because of the pandemic, but having discovered the advantages of early voting and absentee voting, we're not going backwards. So we better figure out how we make it easier and more accessible for people to participate that way. I want to thank our first two panelists and say that they are excused. And I would like to invite our second panel to join us, which is so much easier by Zoom. You don't have to wait for people to get up out of the chairs, the new ones to get into the chairs. Our second panel will be Donna Ellaby, the head of CWA Local 1183, which represents the workers at the Board of Election, as well as Danielle Gerard and Chris Malone, two volunteer members of the VAAC. And in one second, I will tell you what that stands for, Voter Assistance Advisory Committee. And some of us were busy watching their hearing the other evening to hear the public testify to them about some of their opinions and frustrations with the most recent election cycle. So why don't I call on Donna first, and then we'll have the two VACC representatives. And again, there's a 5-minute clock for testifiers, and then a legislator can have 5 minutes to ask questions. If they need a second round, they can let me know. And legislators, you can raise your hand in the panelist section to let me know if you have questions after the full panel. So thank you. Good morning. And thank you, Donna, for being with us. If you are with us, I see your name. You'll need to take yourself off of mute. Hello? Donna, are you there? I see a box. I don't see your picture.
I'm here.
Oh, good. Okay.
And I'm here and I don't know why my last name didn't appear and why I don't appear. I even combed my hair for this.
Well, thank you.
Hey, Donna. In any event,
hello.
You look marvelous.
So I did submit testimony.
Yes.
And I hope that will be circulated to all in attendance.
Yes.
Right now, I would really like to focus on the comments that were made by the first panelists, if I may.
Please.
There was a repeated reference to professionalizing the workers at the Board of Elections. We are trained, we are engaged with DCAS in all sorts of other supervisory trainings, customer service trainings, every type of imaginable review of our procedures is conducted before every single election. And anytime there is a change in election law, we obviously go back to the drawing board and then retrain our workers. This past year, as we all know, posed incredible challenges for us because of the pandemic and the change in executive orders and various new implementation of legislation. The bills that are being proposed presume that we do not have certain ways to evaluate our staff in place, but we do. We have policies and procedures, we have job descriptions, we have a personnel manual, we have evaluations, and we certainly put employees on notice if there's any kind of conduct and performance issue that's not meeting the standards that have been established. While Mr. Thompson spoke to the issue of the board rejecting the mayor's offer for financial resources, I recall that that package included close to $1 million, maybe $2 million for consultants. Whereas the type of resources we need is not being made available by the city. For the last, starting 3 years ago, we requested additional space. And we were on record with OMB as requesting more space. When we have to scale up in such short notice from an average of about 50,000 absentee ballots in a year to close to 700,000, we simply do not have anywhere to put more workers and more ballots. And this year, I tell you, in the Manhattan office, we went from 25,000 as a standard for a general election to the submission of 238,000 valid absentee ballots. And our hallways at our main office were so crowded with racks of ballots that it started to resemble the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory, because even though our exits weren't blocked, there was no way we could have exited quickly because of all of this encumbrance, because of our lack of space. The city has repeatedly ignored our requests for additional space, and this is going on for 3 years now. Our workers put in 80-hour weeks. Yes, they deserve to be incentivized by additional benefits and higher wages, which are historically low compared to other municipal workers. And I do hope the city would give that some consideration. But we also have been repeatedly rebuffed in our efforts to secure additional polling sites that meet the ADA requirements for early voting, and as well as on election day. We have had a number of our polling sites reject us because of the pandemic. And our surveyors have had to go out and do massive revisiting of communities to see how we can accommodate the voters. So while I welcome the opportunity for the executive director and deputy executive director to have full oversight and complete oversight of the workers at the Board of Elections, And I welcome an opportunity to resurrect our labor management committee to see how we can work well in advancing, you know, better performance. Nonetheless, there's certain conditions that were incredible challenges to us. And quite frankly, I don't feel our electeds joined us in our battle for additional early voting sites and resources such as more space and more training sites for our poll workers. So, you know, we lost four of our coworkers to COVID, and over 100 of our members came down with COVID, also members of their family. The mayor's office rebuffed us when we requested PPE. You know, the mayor's office did not suddenly consider us essential when our staff had their children out of school and wanted to enter the enhanced education program. So we do feel often demoralized by the constant attacks because the staff feels they work a tremendously long week, you know, distributing furniture, scanners, which have now entered their 10th year and actually are at a point where they need to be replaced, and scaling up to absentee voting and early voting on such short notice, you know, I think we did an incredible job. But it's like a military deployment, which takes months to gear up to. And clearly there are weaknesses. We wish NYPD officers would show up on time with the keys. That's been an ongoing difficulty for us. We would like to consider split shifts, but yet we have poll workers who want to work the whole day because they need that additional revenue. They need the money. So if wages for poll workers were increased, maybe there would be more of an attraction for doing split shifts. So I'm sorry, I'm sounding like I'm ranting, but I represent close to 800 very, very hardworking people of color at the Board of Elections who have been there and are very dedicated. And I don't feel they really get the respect and recognition that they deserve. Did I use up my 5 minutes yet?
You did, and thank you very much. And just for the record, it is 2020 in America. Everyone is entitled to rant, okay? I'm just saying.
Thank you so much.
We're gonna take the other two panelists and then we'll open up to questions for everyone from the panel. And I'm next gonna go to Danielle Girard, and Chris Malone did get back on, and yet now I don't see him right this second. So we'll go to Danielle Girard first. Morning, Danielle.
Good morning, Senator Krueger. Good morning, all the senators. It's wonderful to see all of you today. I want to thank you for the opportunity to testify before you regarding the New York City Board of Elections and to discuss Senate Bill 2726A. Although I am here as a member of the Voter Assistance Advisory Committee of the Campaign Finance Board, some of the views I express are my own. The VAC has not taken an official position on the bill. So I'd like to start, for example, with thanking you, Senator Krueger, and all the other senators who worked so hard in 2018 to ensure a Democratic majority in New York State Senate. Without all of you, we would not have had early voting in 2019 and this year. Early voting was particularly critical in 2020. Given the coronavirus pandemic and the general election, well over a third of New York City voters participated in early voting. So thank you for that. Regarding the legislation you've introduced to make the city's Board of Elections more professional, this is a commendable first step. The bill provides clear authority for the executive director and the director to enable them to hire, fire, and discipline employees. This will go a long way toward ensuring that staff is qualified for the jobs to which they are assigned, thereby contributing to more professionally run elections and expansion of the franchise. Surely the heroically hardworking members of the board who've been referred to previously, and there are many of them, will welcome these guidelines for the hiring of staff to help them better serve the needs of voters. All of New York's voters could benefit from having decisions regarding, for example, the number of poll sites, how ballots are designed, and what kind of software is used, determined by people with demonstrated expertise in these areas. Based on the experience of the 2020 elections, there is a clear need for other broad, meaningful reforms, including increasing the number of early voting sites in presidential years, as you've heard already, and allowing the processing, if not counting, of absentee ballots before election day. In non-presidential election years, ballots to voters' homes would surely contribute to greater voter turnout. It might make sense to treat proposals like these separately instead of making them part of an omnibus reform bill. Finally, in another view of my own, perhaps the bill could focus even more on standard professional qualifications for Board of Elections personnel rather than on maintaining equal representation of the major political parties across Board of Elections employees. Efforts to reduce the number of people eligible to vote around the United States by one of the major parties since even before the Supreme Court's decision in Shelby County v. Holder became especially blatant in this year's presidential election. It seems anachronistic to consider anything other than professional qualifications in hiring. Again, the bill is a laudable step in the right direction. I urge you and the other senators and the legislature to consider giving the executive director and director of the Board of Elections additional tools to expand the franchise for all New Yorkers.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Danielle. And Chris Malone, are you with us or did you fall off again? I think he did fall off. See, there's a limit to running a democracy under Zoom. None of us have strong enough internet connections. So if Chris comes back on later, I will just make sure to jump him in the next opening there is. I'm going to first ask any of my colleagues if they have any questions for this panel. And I'm looking at the, Senator John Liu had his hand up. Hi, Senator John Liu.
Thank you very much, Senator Krueger. I appreciate Danielle and Donna's testimony. Donna, I think it was helpful for us to hear from your perspective that the offer that the city of New York made was perhaps not really along the lines of what the Board of Elections might need. Do you have any more clarification on that? I heard the point about the consultants not being what the Board of Elections might necessarily need. And have they been able to provide the space that is requisite for the Board of Elections having to handle volumes of work that it previously had not needed to handle?
The offer of financial assistance, I believe, dates back a few years, and it has not been revised, although I can get clarification on that and get back to you. And no, the city has not responded to our requests for additional space.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Senator Krueger.
Thank you. Other colleagues? Oh, Leroy Comrie has his hand up. Hi, Senator Comrie.
Yes, good morning. Good morning, Senator Krueger. I want to thank you and Assemblymember Rosa for everything that you're doing with this topic. I believe I'm a co-sponsor of the bill and have some other bills that we're looking at also. I wanted to ask the second speaker, you know, she said that there was some other tools that they needed to empower the agency. Could she expound on that a little bit? She spoke to that on the end, and I just want to second also her, assertion that it's very important that we make sure that we don't allow for consultants to come in and when we have employees that can make salient suggestions and determinations about what needs to be done. To spend more money on consultants at this point is redundant, other than ensuring that we can have the proper technology so that the staff can use. I don't see the need to be paying millions of dollars in consultant fees again. You know, the staff at the Board of Elections has been undervalued for the efforts that they put in. And it's really about making sure that the management and the city is supporting them in the proper way. But could you expound on what you said about the tools that you think management or the staff needs so that they could be effective? Thank you.
Well, I did mention, thank you, Senator Comrie. I did mention software, and I think that applies across the board. I think the previous speakers have discussed, since we're going to electronic poll books, it probably would be better for people not to have to, if we all ever go back to work, have to go home in order to vote, unless it's convenient and you want to vote in your neighborhood before you go to work. But I think, so there's that aspect of it. I think there, people do need to be trained in a way that the software becomes more second nature. I know that there is a lot of training that goes on, but in the heat of the moment, sometimes it's difficult, especially when faced with new technology. I think somebody mentioned having college students come in. I think that it doesn't mean that we have to exclude people from working two shifts, as one of the previous speakers mentioned, but I think that we could have an option for two shifts. I think that would help attract people who don't want to sit there for the entire time. I think Senator Krueger mentioned that she had attended the Voter Assistance Advisory Committee meeting. And I think it's clear that a lot of the workers do know what they are supposed to do, but you know, we're all human beings and we all make mistakes, and perhaps cheat sheets would help on what it is that you're supposed to do when you're sitting there in the heat of the moment. I also think that the software that can be available really does need to be managed and instituted by people who have experience with it. I can't emphasize that enough.
Thank you. And since you're talking about software, is the infrastructure at the Board of Elections up to date as far as the hardware and the equipment that you need within the offices to be able to respond, especially with ranked choice voting coming up? And I'd ask both panelists that spoken, what do you think is their level of readiness for ranked choice voting elections to happen in February?
I think that the board will be prepared, and it's taking steps to do so. In terms of citywide voting, I think that requires for any voter to go to any location in the county and vote, that's going to take some time to be able to implement, and that requires a major investment.
Well, I do have a bill to address that in one of my proposed bills to allow people to vote through electronic polling and electronic voting from wherever is most convenient for them. Just my final question, since I'm almost out of time. In the primary especially, there was a four-pager that most people had to navigate. Did you get a percentage of how many people actually filled out all four pages, and what was the drop-off in that? And do you think that it'll be even more complicated with ranked choice voting for people to understand the sheets that they'll be handed to? Because we got a lot of complaints that in my area that people weren't even given all four pages when they were supposed to go vote in the primary.
Senator, I can't answer that, but I would love to get back to you with an answer.
Okay, great. Okay. Thank you.
Yes,
go ahead.
I think that has to do with ballot design as well, which is one of the items that I mentioned in my testimony. I think that it's critical that be done in a way that makes it clear and easy for both voters and the staff to and the poll workers to address.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Senator Krueger and Assemblymember Rosa.
Yes, Donna, did you have more follow-up?
I just wanted to make two comments. We recruited 80,000 new poll workers. Again, if we had additional space, we could hire staff that could process all of those applications. But we did process close to 50,000 of those applications and gave them training and put them out to work on for the general election. We tried recruiting college students, and we went through a whole CUNY program to do that a few years ago. And what we discovered is that, not too surprisingly, college students don't like getting up very early in the morning. And they often don't know when their exams are coming up. So they may take a class, and then come election day, they suddenly realize they've got a cram and they can't go to work. But we have a very robust 17-year-old program, which has been quite successful.
Mm. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Donna, I have a number of questions for you, and I appreciate your testimony today and the fact that you say that elected officials may not understand how things actually operate at the board, and yet we're looking at legislating changes. So I would like, one, to say I would love to have follow-up with you after the hearing, because these questions probably don't fit in a tiny little five-minute box. But just to help me understand some of the issues that I think perhaps we're confused about is, one, of course, we do understand that when we're talking about poll workers, we're talking about thousands and thousands of people hired for 2 or 3 days a year, which is different than the permanent employees of the Board of Elections. So I think my questions mostly in this legislation really relates to the permanent employees of the Board of Election, not the poll workers, although there are plenty of issues there. But help me understand, are there specific tests or standards that a worker has to meet before they're hired, as opposed to simply being assigned in by a political leader of one of the two major parties?
Well, every applicant sends in a resume. We also have technical jobs. And obviously for those technical jobs, there's a background in software applications and they're tested. But when we do recruiting and we get resumes, they're reviewed to see whether or not this person will be a good fit. Now, bear in mind, our entry-level positions pay $15 an hour, the same as the GAP, and are in entering into the Board of Elections, the staff is assigned to the registration department where they are trained on the database for registrations. They are given extensive training. They are clocked for how many they can process. All of their errors are reviewed with them. It's both group training and one-on-one training. And if they are unable to measure up after 60 days, it becomes really a question of, are they a good fit for the board? We also have a kind of test by fire, which is an endurance test. Because again, leading up to any election, and now with early voting, 6 weeks before early voting starts, we're working anywhere from 12 to 14 hour days. We get the 14th day off as per our collective bargaining agreement, and not everyone can endure such a rigorous around the clock schedule.
But are there specific standards, and can someone actually be fired if they're hired into the Board of Election, and who is the one who makes the decisions about hiring and firing?
Well, hiring is done at the borough level by the chief and deputy, based on whatever vacancies, Democrat or Republican vacancies, are available. And then supervisors, after training, provide feedback. If there is a performance issue, a conduct issue, a time and attendance issue, those employees are notified. And if they are temporary employees, they can be simply let go for cause. As union president, I preside over a number of hearings when any of those issues for permanent employees arise and a hearing is scheduled and someone can actually be put on probation. And we have employees on probation for various performance issues or time and attendance issues.
And I was advised that the employment job requirements and reviews are not equal from borough to borough, that there are different sets of rules used and evaluation tools used. Is that your understanding, that if I'm in the Bronx, I may face different competency requirements than if I'm in Manhattan versus Staten Island?
No.
It's the same standards that are used for all boroughs?
Yes.
Both for hiring and training?
I would say yes. Now, I am located and I serve as a supervisor, a Democratic supervisor of the early voting department. But my understanding of the boroughs, and I do go out to the boroughs as union president and meet with the chief and deputy in the boroughs, is that the standards are uniform and they're overseen by the executive director and the deputy executive director.
Thank you. My time is up, so I look forward to having continued conversation with you after the hearing. We'll set up a time.
Yes, I welcome it. I welcome it, Senator.
Thank you. And I've just double checked. Did Chris Malone get back on? I fear not.
No, he's still having connection issues.
Okay, thank you, Senator.
Apparently, we should be doing a hearing on Spectrum and whether they actually can run internet in Queens.
You know, we have a couple of Queens legislators on who might be very excited about a
internet. John, Nilly, come on, get on this, people.
You know, I'm only taking on one crisis per hearing. So the internet one is everyone's crisis, by the way. I do understand that. Our next panel, I want to thank two of our three panelists for being with us, and we'll hopefully get Mr. Malone on a little later. Our next panel up is Susan Lerner, the Executive Director of Common Cause, who will then be followed by Jennifer Wilson, Deputy Director of the League of Women Voters. And, I cut off the wrong message. And also Kate Duran of the League of Women Voters. So let's start with Susan Lerner. Good morning.
Mute and start the bit. Sorry. I've had to make some adjustments. There's some work being done in my apartment and the power keeps going out. So I'm on my iPad, which is not necessarily the best. Thank you so much for this opportunity to speak with you this morning. And I want to thank all of the senators and assembly members who are here. This is such an important topic, and there is so much confusion and I think misinformation about where the problems reside and how to address them. It is our contention at Common Cause New York that the Board of Elections is working exactly the way the constitutional and statutory scheme sets it up to work. It is built into the system, in our law, that the Board of Elections is accountable to anybody. It is a strange agency. It claims it's a state agency, but it does not report to any state entities. It's funded by the jurisdiction that it serves on a county or city basis, but it contends that it does not have to report to that entity. And so they manage, there is an interesting space in the law which allows Board of Elections to decide what it wants to do and how to do it, and to be controlled not by a sense of what is needed by the voters and to run our elections efficiently, but to serve political masters. And this is built in not just to the Constitution, but also into our statutes. So Election Law 3-300 basically gives the board exclusive authority to hire and fire its workers. And it's been interpreted by the courts as giving it absolute carte blanche without being answerable to any other authority. The New York City Board has taken that authority to control who it hires and fires and expanded it to argue that it is not answerable to anybody. And we hear this in countless commission meetings where they are told, and the commissioners assert, well, we're not answerable. We don't have to answer to anybody. We're independent and we have absolute authority. That statute could be changed. We have an issue regarding the equipment, which the Board of Elections chooses. Election Law 3-226, again, gives the commissioners the ability to decide equipment. We saw that play out recently in Westchester, where in the middle of a pandemic, the Westchester Board of Elections went to the Board of Legislators and said, you have to float a $6 million bond issue to buy hybrid machines, which the public absolutely does not want, but we've decided we have to buy. And because of cases, the Board of Legislators were advised that they had no alternative but to rubber stamp whatever purchase decisions the Board of Elections chose to make. It is within the purview of the legislature to change that. The New York City constantly complains about the Board of Elections, complains it won't accept money, won't do this, won't do that. And New York City passes laws which direct the Board of Elections to take certain actions, but then New York City does not enforce any of those laws. They don't go to court and try to improve the case law. They just throw up their hands and spend their time complaining that the board doesn't do what they want. There are a lot of things which the city could be doing to be more cooperative. John certainly underlined some of them. And so what we see, and New York City could be using terms and conditions in its budget to require that New York City taxpayer money be spent in one way and not in another, to require specific reporting about how the money is spent. But the city chooses for its own political reasons not to use substantive terms and conditions in any part of its budget, and then complains that the board doesn't do what the city isn't requiring it to do. So, you know, I really feel that we need a very detailed and long-term discussion about the totality of our election law, how it's actually playing out in the administration of our elections, because the board is being blamed, but quite frankly, the system is set up to encourage and allow them to do what everybody is complaining that they are doing. As far as Senator Krueger and Assemblymember Rozick's bill, I think it's an excellent start, but I do have concerns about it. In the first place, what we have seen at Common Cause as a result of the litigation which we filed around the unlawful purging of voters is that not only is there no accountability from the city board to the city or to anybody else, there's really no accountability within the boards between the boroughs. And so long as we have politically appointed executives, whether it's executive, any management, that serves at the absolute, unaccountable, unreviewable pleasure of a politically appointed board of commissioners, then there's no executive who is going to fight with the individual borough leads who are politically appointed and try and overrule them if they want to keep their jobs. If we want to empower the board management and executive team to be able to have oversight over the boroughs, which virtually really doesn't happen extensively in terms of what I see, then the management team has to have a term of contract and they can only be removed for cause. I also would like to suggest that repeating the duality of control between an executive director and a deputy director could potentially lead to a situation where we see a logjam, which we see all the time at the state level in the Board of Elections. So there would need to be, I think, more direct control And I think you need to insulate your management personnel if you want them to really be able to apply oversight from just being dismissed because they took an action which the political powers that be find not acceptable. So my time is up and I will stop.
Thank you, Susan. Next, are we going to Jennifer or Kate?
I'll go first if that's okay.
Certainly, thank you.
Great. Good afternoon. Thank you, Senators and Assemblymember Rozick, for the opportunity to participate in today's roundtable. I am Jennifer Wilson. I'm the Deputy Director of the League of Women Voters of New York State, and I am joined, excuse me, by my colleague, Kate Doran, who is our New York State election specialist and also our very, very knowledgeable guru on all things New York City BOE. So I'm going to yield a lot of my time to Kate, but I do just want to say a few comments about the League being a statewide organization and working a lot directly with county boards of elections. We have 46 local leagues across the state, and we try and connect with the county boards of elections wherever we have representation. And it really varies across the state what that relationship is like. For the most part, it is positive. But I will say that we think that any sort of policy that's going to reform the Board of Elections really should consider looking at the entire state and not just New York City. But we do like this bill. So, so we do like this bill, but we do think that uniform policies across the state would be very positive, especially what's going to benefit a voter in Brooklyn probably will also benefit a voter in Albany or in Ulster County or somewhere else in the state. But there's really three things that we're looking at statewide in terms of what sort of reforms we think that county boards of elections should have. The first is related to staffing and salary. Having some sort of uniform processes for hiring staff, salary standards, but also having adequate funds for counties, making sure that county boards of elections aren't being told to hire people with a master's level degree, but then their county only gives them like a $10,000 hiring budget. That's not going to work. The second part of that is potentially looking at making commissioners outside of New York City full-time, especially in these smaller counties where they don't really have a lot of staff. The commissioners are all that's there. If they're not fully devoted to working on the election, there's going to be some issues there. Transparency and accountability. I think all of the voting rights groups are in agreement that there needs to be greater transparency and accountability, having regularly scheduled meetings, transparency in election results reporting, a directive to have an accurate and up-to-date website and social media. There are some counties out there that websites are very out of date. And then finally, uniform standards and practices for oversight authority, whether that's the State Board of Elections or the district attorney or somebody just overseeing what county boards are doing. We saw this a lot during the pandemic, especially in the primary, where the governor or the legislature directed county boards to do something and they just didn't do it. And whether that was a lack of funding or just they didn't have time to do it, there needs to be some sort of oversight in there where if we're telling you to do something, you have to do it. I think these three things will go a long way. And the last piece of this is, of course, funding. We can't ask them to do all these things without giving them funding. So I'm going to yield the rest of my time to Kate to talk more specifically about Senator Krueger and Assemblywoman Rozick's bill.
Thank you, Jennifer. Hi, Kate. You just need to unmute yourself.
Thank you very, very much. I am thrilled to be here. I will tell you that I live in Brooklyn. I have been a poll worker since 2004. I was promoted later to be a poll site coordinator, and now I've been working at early voting, and it was a pleasure to feel to be amongst the ranks of essential workers during this election period. So, as my colleague Jennifer Wilson has said, the League is interested in a statewide transformation of our boards of elections, but we all understand a fundamental change is going to require a constitutional amendment. We welcome those conversations and we look forward to the research and collaboration that will ensue. But today, Senator Krueger and Senator Hoylman and Assemblywoman Rozick, we are supporting this smaller preliminary foray into that larger reform. And we really thank you for your courage in introducing this. and for inviting us to speak. As I said, I've been a poll worker since 2004, and I have horror stories of Board of Election dysfunction, and I feel like here's the place I could tell you about it if you wanted to hear them. Anyhow, as we know, the New York City Board of Elections stands uniquely apart from every other Board of Election in the state. It's specifically mentioned in the election law. It's a behemoth compared to any other Board of Election, and there is no transparency. For example, I was thrilled just now to meet Donna Ellaby. She described herself as serving as the Democratic supervisor of the early voting department. I've never even seen this woman. Her picture does not appear in the Board of Elections annual report. There are splashy professional photos of nearly everyone else. This woman sounds very important, but she's hidden. And I just learned this morning, she said she represents approximately 800 people. Although, is that the totality of the number of people who work in the five borough offices? I don't know. I struggled yesterday to find something in preparation for this testimony. I could find nothing, but maybe that's a clue. Anyhow, we support S-2726 in the specifics of providing for express powers given to a CEO. A CEO consisting of the executive director and the deputy executive director. And we welcome the measures of accountability that are apparent in the bill. The chief executives would have to consult with DCAS. And we think this is a wonderful, wonderful improvement. Now, I know that some have said that this legislation does not go far enough, but we think that it is an excellent start. And the change in New York City can point the way to changes in our local suburban counties, our neighboring counties of Westchester, Nassau, and Suffolk, which could use some change, I think. And then we can look at the rest of the state. Thank you again, very, very much. Oh, I want to say one more thing. The split shifts was recommended by several people. I believe, that if the New York City Board of Elections doesn't go with creating an alternative staffing plan that's described in the election law currently, section 3-500, if they don't go with that alternative plan, if they insist on the election district model, they're not going to be able to successfully implement split shifts. It's easy to slot somebody in if you have duties of being a poll station person or you're printing ballots. But if you're working at an ED table, it's difficult. And I think that the two need to be considered together. And I think we should be pushing the New York City Board of Elections to do that because that's in the law right now. They can do that now.
Thank you very much. And well, thank all three of you. But again, two points that I think you were all talking about was this is a statewide issue. We know that. That's why Zelmer Myrie, the chair of the Elections Committee, earlier on pointed out that his committee will be working on a large volume of additional election reforms come the new year. The reason that Neely and I decided to do the roundtable today was to have an opportunity to really try to dive into the problems we are seeing in New York City and the potential to try to do some fixes around the City Board of Election, because we do understand the politics here are very complicated county by county around the state. So appreciate the league's work in all these different counties because it's a slightly different story in any county you go to. And that, you know, New York City, where obviously we all come from today, is also sort of the 600-pound gorilla in the room of elections. So we thought it was worthwhile to start to really dig into what we could do absent constitutional change to fix the city board. So please, anyone who's testifying today, anyone who wants to submit testimony to us afterwards and who's listening today, I think that we're very interested in trying to make this the strongest bill we can. And if there's specific other recommendations for this bill, specifically for New York City, get those recommendations to us. Now, Susan Lerner, you highlighted something I didn't even know about, that the Westchester commissioners decided they had to buy new voting machines suddenly in the middle of a pandemic and just ordered the board to have the county legislature to come up with the money to pay for them. Could that happen?
$6 million bond issue in the middle of a pandemic.
With no public participation, no hearing about the types of...
Tons of public participation, vociferous opposition by the public, and advice from the county attorney that the legislature had no discretion to turn down the request because of 3-226 in election law and how it's interpreted by the courts.
And so that's the same storyline could in fact happen here in New York City as well?
Yes.
And could I fix it in this bill, or would I have to be going for some broader statewide legislative change?
So at Common Cause, we are always a bit concerned about patchwork fixes for a particular jurisdiction. I think, yes, you could address that here and give more oversight to New York City's budget process in terms of equipment determinations, because there is a similar issue which could come up with our city board and very expensive hybrid machines, which are vociferously opposed by many of us, that the board wants to purchase that would cost tens of millions of dollars. Ideally, I think we need an overhaul of our entire election law to bring it up to the 21st century standard and to be sure that all of the pieces interlock appropriately. But yes, you could address it in this bill. I'm not sure that doing New York City alone might be the most advantageous.
I appreciate that. And that's why I'm so glad that Zelnor is here with us today. Because I do agree that we should be doing statewide reforms of voting rights and elections. But I'm also very concerned, because I had also heard the rumor of this for New York City. I mean, I'm old enough now that I was involved, or old enough as a legislator that I was involved last time round when the feds changed the law on us and everybody was rushing into contracts with voting machine companies without doing their due diligence. And New York ended up being the last place in the country to choose new machines. And I was proud of it, that I was helping to delay the process until we could get as many answers as we could, as many changes in the proposals that we could, and that we protected the auditable ballot tracking option in our voting system, which I don't think any of us are doubting today, all these years later, why that was so important. So it truly scares me that boards of election may be rushing forward for various reasons to rush to do new contracts for enormously expensive machines where the people are not being listened to. So I'll tell you right now, if we don't think we can get a fix statewide, I'm committed to try to get a fix for New York City as soon as possible. Because it's also true often that other counties will hold up on what they decide to do with machine and other purchases until they've seen what the 600-pound gorilla is going to do. That was the story last time round, and I think that's also important for us to think about. So I've now pretty much used up my 5 minutes of questioning to rant in response to your story about something that's already happening that we need to be very much on top of. Because I didn't even realize Westchester has done this.
There also is a bill which would outlaw the hybrid machines that were purchased under those extreme circumstances and would prevent New York City from the board from purchasing similar machines.
And can you in 18 seconds explain what a hybrid machine is?
Yes, it's a machine that uses a touchscreen to print a ballot that the voter does not touch, that they look at through a screen that has in the same unit a printer and a scanner, and is considered by election security experts to be vulnerable to hacking.
Thank you. Do any of my colleagues have any questions for this panel? John, are you smiling with a yes or a no?
I'm smiling because I'm happy and therefore I have no questions.
Okay. All right. And I don't see any coming from Neely or Zelnor either right now. So I want to thank this panel very much for your participation today. And I suspect we'll also be following up with you. And again, everyone is welcome to make additional recommendations to this bill. Okay, thank our you. Next panel.
Thank you.
Thank you very kindly.
Thank you. Our next panel, sorry. We have, We have Perry Grossman, Senior Staff Attorney at New York Civil Liberties Union, Neil Rosenstein, the Government Reform Coordinator at NYPIRG, Chi-Sun Lee, the Deputy Director of the Election Reform Program at the Brennan Center. Great, and why don't we just do it in the order I said the names. So, Perry Grossman.
Thank you so much, Senator Krueger. It's a pleasure to be here, pleasure to see everybody. I have the pleasure of working with a lot of the folks who testified already, and I appreciate everything they have to say and all of their hard work in making, New York elections possible. Certainly, we have a lot of contact with the Board of Elections and the city and the Campaign Finance Board and everybody. And I know these are all, hardworking people who are doing the best they can. And so with that acknowledgement, New York elections are terrible. So it's not like we're not in need of reform. I'm sitting here listening to, hearing what everybody is doing and pointing the finger, right? The Board of Elections points the finger at the city. The city points the finger back at the Board of Elections. Everybody points the finger back at the state. And everybody seems to point the finger at the Campaign Finance Board from time to time. And it's exhausting, right? Nobody is actually taking responsibility for making sure that our elections function. And that is an incredibly frustrating prospect. Certainly, I have seen the city and worked with the city to make sure that there are adequate sites available and adequate funding available and adequate space available. So it's frustrating to hear pushback like that. I also know that the Board of Elections, is working incredibly hard to try and get the job done as well. But we still hear tons of complaints about, the quality of the staff and of the work that gets done. We do know that voter registrations get processed incredibly slowly. We know that the sort of customer service facing aspects of the Board of Elections are slow and frequently contain misinformation. And it's very difficult for us to get the data we need to make the evidence-based prescriptions for reform. So certainly I appreciate this bill. I don't have anything against it, but it's really difficult to make the more specific targeted recommendations without getting the data we need from the Board of Elections, from the State Board of Elections, on the things, the metrics that we would need to see how we can improve how voter registrations get processed, where better early voting sites could be placed, who's resisting being an early voting site and why. It's not just the arts institutions, it's a lot of places. And to give some credit to the Board of Elections, I know they're trying to identify places and they get a lot of pushback. So one of the things I'll just point to is, I think the New York Voting Rights Act, which I believe every member of the Senate who's currently on this call has signed on to as a co-sponsor. It's S7528A in the Assembly. It's A10841. Contains a number of provisions that I think would help us improve the function of elections in New York State through litigation, but also through data. There is a really important data component to that bill that would help us make the recommendations we need to go forward. So, I would say I think there's a lot of value to the professionalization aspects of this bill. I think there's a lot of value to the accountability aspects of the bill. Certainly providing for more uniform standards, published standards that we can all see, would be helpful to ensure that we're able to hold the Board of Elections and its employees accountable for doing their jobs. Also making sure that the state is adequately funding elections, putting election funding constantly in the hands of the localities. And obviously New York City is a locality unlike any other. I say that with a great deal of pride as a fifth generation New Yorker, but it's still susceptible to the same local squabbles that happen everywhere else. And so, I think that that's an important thing we need to look at. But I don't want to waste anyone's time without more detailed commentary. So I'm happy to yield to my very excellent co-panelists.
Thank you very much. Okay, so Neil Rosenstein from New York Public Interest Research Group, NYPIRG. Go off of mute, Neil.
There we go. I have a little non-contagious cough, but I'm on mute. Thank you, Senator Krueger, Assemblymember Rozick, for your bills and for convening this roundtable and the opportunity to join in. We have a message similar to our other colleagues. We'll also talk about some specifics of the bill, but basically one person, one vote, one state, one election system. We think that's what we should have. Whether you're in Buffalo or the Bronx or Brookhaven, New York's election should be professionalized and they should be uniform across the state. And this year we saw problems in New York City, certainly with long lines. And we also saw efforts in other parts of the state to limit students' access to the polls. We saw one county up in Oneida and others that decided to ignore what this legislature did, decide not to accept affidavit ballots potentially from voters who moved or to show them to candidates so they can challenge them in the process and see if they're counted. This is a statewide issue, and election reform legislation, we think ultimately should not just address the shortcomings of the city board, but the entire system of which it's part. Now, the state constitution clearly limits the authority of the legislature in some areas of election administration. However, we have a slightly different opinion from some other folks. We think you have a lot of power to make significant changes to the state elections. And Article 2 of the state constitution, suffrage, states, all laws creating or regulating or affecting boards or officers charged with the duty of qualifying voters or of distributing ballots to voters or of receiving, recording, or counting votes at elections shall secure equal representation of two political parties. It goes on, all such boards and officers shall be appointed or elected in such manner and upon the nomination of such representatives of said parties respectively as the legislature, as you folks may direct. Now, that provision we think has been incorrectly interpreted to lock in the requirement that the two major political parties shall secure equal representation in the administration of elections and all employees. The Constitution does not say the state even has to have county board of elections, that every board employee has to have an opposing political party counterpart, or that political parties decide who among their ranks are to be placed in elections administration's positions. The Constitution only states that boards and officers must be chosen upon the nomination of such representatives of said parties. But once again, as you folks, as the legislature may direct. And we think this clause authorizes the legislature to restrict the types of individuals the political parties may nominate for positions contained within the state board, as well as provide a basis for rethinking our county-based patronage board structure. A lot of that goes to your bill. So with that in mind, we would support the following changes to New York's current system of election administration, some of which we think we put in the bill as well. But first, the state board should establish and would establish a uniform statewide administration of elections. A minimum of staff necessary that work for the board would still meet the constitutional requirements, but all employees would be required to meet civil service standards, including passing relevant exams. We think there should be an elimination of all county and city boards of elections. There should be one agency that runs elections with consistent standards of administration across the state. the establishment of regional administrators or offices to help monitor local elections, as well as ensure that partisan interests are heard, could be integrated into this one statewide entity. And we also think your legislation and our separate should improve boards with new conflicts of interest and diversity provisions. The city board's history of nepotism has been very well chronicled. And based on the powers of the legislature to direct the method and qualifications of commissioners and employees, we urge reform legislation to include a conflicts of interest clause that disallows any commissioner to be appointed if they or an immediate family member have held or campaigned for elected office, if they've held or campaigned for a party position, if they've been a registered lobbyist or a registered client or a consultant to a political campaign, or participated in paid partisan campaign work for the last 5 years. A mandate that these commissioners, appointees, and employees affirm that they shall maintain a fiduciary relationship to the board and the public, including an oath to administer the laws in a nonpartisan way, free of political interest, and a mandatory requirement that the board members be representative of the broad diversity of the state. And, you know, 2726A and 11169 can begin this transformation. And we thank you for their introduction. There's a bedrock principle that we support behind these bills who place many employment decisions in the hands of executives and deputy executive directors. And you know, some people have said it, for too long, they serve as fall guys or fall gals, taking the blame when things go wrong. And as Susan said, that's how it's set up. And that might work for a film plot, a fall guy or a fall gal. And it may work well for the commissioners and the party leaders who accept executive directors, but it's been a dismal failure for running elections. So at a minimum, we urge these bills be amended to apply to boards statewide, to include the conflicts of interest provisions I just outlined for commissioners, grant executive directors fixed terms so they don't have to live in fear of their jobs when they make those decisions. And we think that'll greatly increase the intent of the legislation to decrease the influence of commissioners and increase accountability. And thank you for the opportunity to testify today.
Thank you, Neil. Okay, Chi-Sun, welcome.
Hello, everyone. Good morning, Senator Krueger. And it's nice to see Senator Myrie, Senator Liu, and so many I miss seeing in person. Thank you for inviting us. The Brennan Center has been working to improve elections in cities and states across the country, including here in New York and at the federal level for many years. So we appreciate this chance to speak about the urgency of reforming the City Board of Elections and commend Senator Krueger and her colleagues for prioritizing this need. But first, it's worth noting that New York has made some important strides in recent years to help voters. The Let New York Vote Coalition, of which the Brennan Center and many of my co-panelists are active members, worked with many of you in the legislature to achieve passage of early voting last year, without which the problems of this year's general election would have been much worse. And we're on the cusp of bringing automatic voter registration to New York once Governor Cuomo signs the bill. This reform will enable easier, more accurate maintenance of voter information and could enroll more than 1 million more New Yorkers to vote. But the potential for such reforms to increase voter engagement and win the public's trust depends on how well they're administered. We've seen too much evidence this year of persistent failures in election administration by the City Board of Elections, including a flawed rollout of mail ballots, widespread mistrust of voting by mail during a pandemic, egregiously long lines at the polls, and continued concerns that partisan patronage undermines professionalism at this crucial public service agency. New Yorkers deserve much better. And the relative absence of existing law in New York imposing requirements for election administrators or consequences for poor performance leaves a great deal of room for improvement. And this bill is a notable step in the right direction. From the Brennan Center's perspective, gained from working on election administration across the country, and especially during this most consequential election year, the progress we make here in New York could benefit the integrity of elections nationwide. The failures of election administration we see here can be as troubling as problems in battleground states that draw national outrage over vote suppression. What New York does to improve the actual and perceived quality of our elections could well set the bar for the rest of the country. On a national scale, the 2020 election made clear the enormous difference sound election administration can make in upholding our democracy. In places across the country, local election officials prepared to ensure this year's elections would be secure. They updated technology, they created backup plans, strengthened information sharing, tightened coordination with state and federal government. And these steps not only protected against the kinds of hacks we saw in 2016, but they also ensured people were able to vote even if technical glitches happened. They ensured an accurate, well-documented national count. It is these efforts of high quality election administration that are shoring up our elections in the face of relentless, baseless attacks on the integrity of the vote from no less than the White House. These attacks pile on top of still too common practices that hinder the right of Black and Brown Americans to vote. It has never been more critical for our democracy that voters be able to trust their election administration to be competent, prepared, focused on public service above all, and fair. We're lucky that this trust has largely held for the nation overall, but these attacks show we can't count on that trust in the future. And in New York, where voter trust in the Board of Elections is constantly shaken, we need to take on the challenge of fundamental reform. The legislature's work to strengthen confidence in election administration by improving standards for professionalism, improving accountability and improving transparency could set an example for the nation at a moment when it is most needed. So we at the Brennan Center look forward to working with all of our colleagues, working on improving elections and in the legislature to make this happen soon. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So there's a lot of meat from all of you, and I'm sure that my colleagues will also have questions. Just a couple from me to start. So Neil is proposing we start again. We get rid of county boards of election. We create a state agency, and the state would then be responsible for making sure elections function throughout the state. I've always worried that the state of New York doesn't even like to go to localities to do something. So are there other states that run a statewide system instead of counting on their locals to get it done? You're muted, Neil. Oh, there you are.
We're looking at a lot of other different models. And clearly, there's a lot of models very different than the patronage-based county system that we have with secretaries of state, or New Jersey with a statewide elections commission, which is really making things a bit more uniform. We want to take as much discretion away from possible at the local level. We have these idiosyncrasies and biases introduced into the system. Now, you may end up with a regional structured or a place in individual county structure, just like New York could be one county board, Nassau could be one county board, the Mid-Hudson Valley, Albany. You know, the number of districts we're not set on or administrative units, and they could each within them, and I think the Constitution might argue, have units that are dealing particularly with counties and local elections. But you would have uniform practices that would be across the state. And we wouldn't see all these crazy things that happen where you have a purge just in Brooklyn, where you have affidavits challenged in Oneida, or you have students, you know, locked out of poll sites in Dutchess County. And there would be one standard for all, which basically one person, one vote. And we think we're dangerous right now in New York. I think people could challenge a lot of what we do on the basis that voters are treated so differently.
Thank you. And Perry, you talked about the need for money. So has anybody, and this is probably a question for all three of your organizations, has anybody done a study? Do we really underfund elections per capita here in New York compared to other places in the country?
I'll go first. I don't know if we underfund elections compared to other places in the country, but we don't have the number of early voting sites we need. We don't have the technology that we need to provide citywide or countywide early voting in New York City. We could have a better, we could have professional election administrators in a way that we don't currently have, but we don't fund that either. You know, there are so many things that we could do differently, but mostly, and I think this occurs more outside of New York City than inside of New York City, is that the budget becomes a political cudgel for the local legislature to bludgeon the Board of Elections. And I've seen it more often, to be candid, in counties where the legislature is dominated by Republicans, because it's always easier to defund elections into disenfranchising people than it is to overfund elections into enfranchising more people. But you know, it is the ability to use those budgets as a form of political pressure that leads to lower quality elections outside of New York City. Here we seem to have the reverse problem, which is, you know, the city council seems to be generally willing, and the mayor's office seems to be generally willing to put money in the hands of the Board of Elections. And the Board of Elections, you know, whether it is because they are constrained by the State Board of Elections or believe that they are constrained by the State Board of Elections or simply don't want the money or who knows what, that doesn't seem to be getting through in a way that's meaningful. So, you know, without regard to other states, we underfund elections here. That I will say for certain.
Any of my colleagues have any questions for this panel? Raise your hand either electronically or physically. John Liu.
Senator Krueger, I don't have questions because these three have been extremely clear in what they want and why we need it. So I want to thank them for always offering their advice and suggestions and ideas, solicited as well as unsolicited. And I've got plenty of marks on my neck from their efforts. So thank you.
Thank you. I don't want to see the marks on your neck. I don't think any of these three people are violent. I refuse to accept that, but I know what you meant. So actually, these were our last panelists today. Anyone else want to ask the panel any more questions? Ms. Elmore, hi.
Hey, so I don't have a question. I did want to echo Senator Liu's sentiments in gratitude to the panel for all of what they offered, and of course our previous panelists as well. We really do look forward to working with you in the coming weeks and months on the necessary changes, and are always grateful that you lend your time and expertise to our efforts.
Okay. And since this is really time for closing remarks, is there anything else you would like to close with, Senator Myrie?
All right, I'll jump into the closing remarks then. Let me, of course, thank you, Senator Krueger, for convening this. I think we heard a lot of good things today, a lot of things for us to consider. I think a recurring theme is that we have work to do in New York City and we have work to do statewide. And I'm grateful to have you as a colleague, Senator Krueger, who has been focused on the city issue for quite some time. And so the elections committee will be working diligently on this. And we look forward to getting input on this bill and into looking into any amendments that may be forthcoming. And of course, Assemblymember Rozick for your co-sponsorship. You know, I think I'll end sort of how I started, in that the number one person and constituency in all of this is the voter. All of us on this Zoom, we sort of eat, breathe, and live this stuff, but everyday voters don't really care about what's happening in the background or what's in the state constitution or what professionalization means. They don't care about any of that. They want to be able to exercise their constitutional right and to do so in the easiest and most accessible way possible. And the responsibility for all of us, both the policymakers and those of us who are advocating, is to perform for the voters. And so I'm very grateful to be a part of this effort today. And again, thank Senator Krueger for her leadership on this issue. We look forward to working together to make sure we get it done for the voters.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. I look forward to working with you and your committee, even though I'm not a member of your committee. You just can't get rid of me. I care that much about elections. I keep showing up and demanding things. And Assemblywoman Rozick.
I just also want to say a big thank you to Senator Krueger and all the other senators for doing this roundtable so efficiently and so quickly after the general election that just happened. it's clear that we have a lot to do both in the city and statewide. And I know that many of the experts that we heard from are not strangers to us or to these issues. So we'll be leaning heavily on your expertise as well. And again, just a thank you all around.
And I, in closing, would also like to thank everyone who participated today, my colleagues who joined with us and listened attentively, the panelists who submitted testimony, and we will be distributing the testimony through the state Senate system to everyone. So everyone will have access to the testimony. And to really highlight, I think, something that did come out of this, which is we have statewide problems, and there's certainly a logic for there to be statewide solutions. I don't know about a statewide system, Neil. I'm just not sure we'll ever quite see that. But at the same time, New York City is 8.5 million people with a really disturbingly low voter participation rate. But with all these changes that have been taking place through the statutory changes we have made, and I still would take the position that it is a worthy cause to try to make improvements in the administration of the elections in New York City, given the fact that we've made so many changes, we're continuing to make the next set of changes with ranked choice voting. We've done the early voting, but we have to fix things. We've done the expansion of absentee, but we have to fix things. That this really is the right time in history to be taking a hard look at what our city board of election is set up to do correctly, and which is set up to not be able to accomplish its goals. So I do look forward to us moving forward legislatively to see how far we can move the temperature of other colleagues to make some significant changes, because we shouldn't forget the fact that behind all of this is a model that is defined as partisan. And whenever you're opening the door to some changes in the decision-making for elections where there's a partisan system, just know there are some of us who come from a different philosophy from each other who aren't sure they want anybody changing the rules of the road. I feel very strongly that we need to change the rules of the road to make sure that we are maximizing every New Yorker's opportunity to vote, because as we are watching right now in this country, when you don't make sure everyone has the right to vote, you end up in bizarro situations where a president is saying maybe he's not leaving after he's lost an election. We have states proposing lawsuits against each other's legal election processes, which is potentially equivalent to declarations of civil war between the states. And these are not our issues in New York, but we have to make sure, like every state in the country, that we are doing everything we can to make sure all our citizens have the equal right to access their vote, to participate, and to have their vote counted. There's almost nothing else more important to the future of our democracy. And so I want to thank everyone for your participation today, and for my colleagues for the continued challenges we face in the new year. And we know already the challenges we are facing on so many issues, but I don't think we get to say elections are done yet. They're not. We have more work to do, and I think we're up to it. So with that, I'm going to close this roundtable and thank everyone for your participation today. Stay healthy and safe.